Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar today. I'm Amanda Degro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Martin Barasco with Becker LLC, Jerry Grady, Ali Baydun, and Lonnie Winkler with UHY LLP. Marty has been a managing member of Becker LLC since 2006. Under his leadership, the firm has grown into one of the premier boutique firms with offices in New York, New Jersey, California, and Philadelphia. Marty leads a staffing team within the firm dedicated to studying the best legal practices within the staffing and healthcare industries. His philosophy is to direct clients towards legal strategies that facilitate growth and increase entrepreneurial value and in the long term. He often works as part of a team with leading investment bankers, accountants, and risk managers to implement comprehensive growth strategies for clients. Marty is a frequent contributor to legal and business publications and lectures across the country on emerging issues impacting the staffing industry. Jerry, partner with UHY, has acquired a wealth of knowledge throughout his nearly 35 years in public accounting. He is a leading member of the firm's Nation Management and Technology Consulting Services Group, as well as member of the National International Financial Reporting Standards Committee. Jerry is also a chairperson for the firm's national staffing practice. Ali, principal at UHY, is a lead member of the Enterprise Business Services team and has experience providing advisory, tax, and attest service for the middle market clients. Ali specializes in manufacturing, software, and printing industries. Lonnie, principal at UHY, is a leading member of the tax department and has over 15 years of experience in public accounting. Congress enacted the CARES Act some 45 days ago. Through the CARES Act, the Paycheck Protection Program, PPP, was created. To expedite the disbursement of funds, the Small Business Loan Program was initially rolled out with only minimal official guidance. The administration has been slowly releasing frequently asked questions and guidance that is in some cases fundamentally changing the rules. In addition to the PPP, there were many tax changes in the CARES Act which benefit the staffing industry, which has had little to no exposure. In today's TRICOM Industry Insider webinar, legal and accounting experts from Becker and UHY will share their knowledge and their insights on the rules as we have know them today, as to how effectively navigate the ongoing uncertainty surrounding the PPP loan program, focusing on certification issues and loan forgiveness calculations. They will also review the tax updates and changes, which may allow staffing firms the opportunity for tax credits and cash flow improvement opportunities. If you have any questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat feature. And with that, I will turn the floor over to our panelists.
Thanks so much, Amanda. We would first like to thank TRICOM for allowing us to be able to present the PPP certification update, loan forgiveness application, and the CARE tax updates to all of you today. As Amanda said, you know, we are ourselves and Becker have been doing this seminar quite a lot the last couple of weeks. Everything changes on a weekly basis. Everything's changing on a daily basis. And there were some updates last night that we may or may not get to because they're not law yet, but there are some positive things happening through the House and through the Senate that you could hopefully see. Our goal today, as you see, is we want to give you a little bit of update on the certification because that was a big issue that was flying around for about a month, month and a half. They finally have some resolution on that. And some of you may still be a little concerned on what you need to do if you did receive some large dollars in lending. We also want to give you an overview of the loan forgiveness. That's really where we think a lot of the meat is going to be for today's session. They did come out with a lot of updates over the Memorial Day weekend. And so we've updated all the slides and all the information for you. A lot of good changes did come out, some changes that some people were not expecting, but it'll give you an idea to helpfully plan. And then we do want to get, as we talked about, we do want to get to some of the tax updates that are out there, because there was a lot of confusion around the credits that were there and also the FICA deferral. And then there's some other items that we believe staffing firms can use and benefit from. What we do want to preface, though, before we start, is that the information you are getting right now is as of May 29th, 2020. And with the lawyer on the phone, I want to make sure that I say it is subject to change. So we are giving our legal disclosure for you, because all this information is changing rapidly. And in addition, we are recommending that you reference the SBA website for any updates on a daily basis, or to discuss with your advisor for any of those changes as well. So what I'd like to do is first start about how the PPP came about through the CARES Act, where we call CARES Act 2 and CARES Act 3. And most of you have already borrowed, you've already applied for your loans, you've already had the loan approved, and then you've already got your loans funded. There are many people out there that may have already been funded back in the beginning of April, and therefore your 8-week period is coming up very quickly. And so our goal here is to just talk through each one of these steps to give you an idea and information on what you have to be concerned with. And what I'd like to do is I'm going to turn it over to Marty, and Marty's going to talk about some of the questions out there on the certification process, which we have called FAQ 39, FAQ 46, and FAQ 48. So Marty, if you want to go ahead and start on some of that, that would be great.
Thanks, Jerry. Happy to do that. I always feel more comfortable when somebody gives a great disclaimer up front on a webinar. So thank you very much. Yes, in addition to being eligible as a borrower, every borrower had to certify in good faith that the PPP loan was necessary. And what that has meant has been a bit of a roller coaster ride with a number of twists and turns. As the SBA has issued guidance throughout the last 45 days. Originally, the standard appeared as though it was going to be a very low standard. The certification, it just simply says that current economic uncertainty makes this loan request necessary to support the ongoing operations of the applicant. So at first this appeared as though it would be a very low standard, that the only thing that an applicant or a borrower needed to show was that the crisis had created some economic uncertainty for them. They didn't even necessarily have to show that it created a negative economic impact. They just needed to show that it had created economic uncertainty. Well, that kind of got turned upside down as the SBA issued its guidance, and where it started to get turned upside down was with FAQs 31 and 37. In FAQs 31 and 37, the SBA indicated in its guidance that this was not only an economic uncertainty test, but there was a liquidity test as well. And what those two FAQs indicated was that borrowers had to look determine whether or not they had access to other liquidity, meaning liquidity outside of the PPP loan that was readily available to them that they could use to bridge the negative economic impact that was occurring as a result of the crisis. So FAQ 31 and 37 moved this from a pretty simple one-part test to a much more complex two-part test. You still had to show economic uncertainty, but you also had to show that you didn't have access to other liquidity that the gap. And since FAQ 31 and 37 come down, the SBA has issued a number of other FAQs that have further helped define and provide guidance on what the certification test is. In FAQ 39, they indicated that they were going to review all loans over $2 million. And then the latest FAQs that came out on May 13th, FAQ 46 being the most important of these, in FAQ 46, they created a safe harbor for borrowers under 2 million. So in FAQ 39, they indicated that they were going to audit everyone over 2 million, but they still hadn't indicated whether or not they would be auditing borrowers under 2 million. In FAQ 46, the SBA indicated that it was not going to be auditing borrowers under 2 million, that they were going to be giving a safe harbor because the SBA was presuming that small borrowers would not have access to liquidity. And therefore they were presuming that the certification that borrowers under 2 million executed was in fact executed in good faith. The other thing that FAQ 46 indicated, and this is important because it really puts a bullseye on borrowers over 2 million, is it indicated again, not that this was just going to be a review, but in fact, it was going to be an audit. At first, that was unclear. Secretary Manchin had indicated an audit, but the language in FAQ 39 indicated a review. Well, the dreaded audit word appeared in FAQ 46 again. So it's clear now that this is going to be an audit, although the scope of the audit has not been indicated yet. It also put guidance on what the approach was that the SBA was going to take with borrowers over 2 million, who it found did not execute the certification in good faith. And in FAQ 46, the SBA indicated that what it was going to do, if it found that, is it was going to force the borrowers to pay the money back, and it was going to not permit those borrowers to get any forgiveness. So what borrowers have to understand over 2 million is that the forgiveness process, at least initially, is going to take place before the audit. Forgiveness is going to take place over the next 60, 90 days, as Ali will explain in detail in a little bit. The audit is going to take place after that. So what the SBA has indicated is if they find in the audit that a borrower over 2 million did not execute this certification in good faith, and in fact, this loan wasn't necessary to keep their ongoing and to support their ongoing operations, that borrower, even though their SBA lender may have indicated that they were going to get forgiveness, will forfeit that forgiveness. Now, as long as a borrower pays back the money, then the SBA has indicated it won't take further administrative actions, such as filing litigation and criminal or civil claims under the False Claims Act. So FAQ 46 is very important in two ways. One, it provides the safe harbor for borrowers under 2 million. And two, it really indicates the bullseye that's going to be on the back of borrowers over 2 million. One important thing for borrowers to understand that determining whether you're a borrower over 2 million, the SBA has indicated that it will look at the borrowings of your affiliates too. So, example, if you have a staffing firm and it has several different subsidiaries or brother sister companies that under the SBA rules would be considered affiliates, if one of those affiliates borrowed 1.7 million and another affiliate borrowed 800,000, the SBA has indicated it will add those loans together and you will be over 2 million and subject to audit. So I think that's a very important point for folks on the phone to understand, is that the SBA for audit purposes, at least as of now, is going to be looking cumulatively at all companies with affiliates and their borrowings. I think that Jerry, for us, we've been talking to our clients now that the safe harbor period to return the money is passed, about how they should be preparing for their audits. And I know you're doing the same with your clients. Maybe you could talk to the audience today about what you're telling your clients about preparing for the audits and how you're helping them prepare for those audits.
The one of the things that we're looking at is, you know, liquidity was a big issue. And for many staffing firms, especially those staffing firms that may have been in the essential world, liquidity is going to be a concern for all of you. Because were you able to still get dollars from the bank, or were you able to still get dollars from your funding corporations? And what you have to do is you have to demonstrate to the SBA during this audit process what would happen to you from a liquidity standpoint if those funds were not available? And so we put together a list. There's about 12 or 15 different items that we've been really focusing on for the staffing clients. And what we're looking at is that if you've already received a lot of requests that you had to reduce charges or you had to reduce hours from your clients back in March, April, and even during May, it's important that you document those. You should create an SBA certification file and start documenting, printing any emails that you've received from your clients saying that, hey, we need to push out our receivables another 25, 30, 45 days. We also need to, remove 45, 50 people. We had an IT staffing firm that was humming along in April, was humming along in March, and all of a sudden, right in the middle of May, right before they got their PPP loan, 55 people were laid off from one of their clients that they had, and they're not going to be brought back to at least July or August. That is detrimental. That is what they're looking for. That is going to have a real serious effect because that's 55 people that have to be paid or put on unemployment. And the idea was this was a PPP, a Paycheck Protection Program. We also are looking at making sure that you look at what is your working capital look like? Did you have enough working capital to pay for all your fixed overhead if all your clients decided that they were going to lay off every single temp that you had out there? Were you going to be able to cover your overhead, both internal payroll as well as the fixed fees such as rent, utilities, any type of workers' comp that you might still have to pay, your health insurance? All those items you want to take a look at. So looking at the working capital is extremely important. The other issue is that some banks did get very tight and they were pretty quick to the trigger in letting clients know that, hey, we are not going to allow you to borrow funds. We are going to hold off. We're not going to allow you to borrow any more funds. You want that email. If you have an email like that, you want that. Also, what are the significant risks? And when I talk about significant risk, if you had 20 people in a plant and one person ended up with COVID in that plant, what would that have meant to those 20 people that were in that plant? The odds are the plant would have to shut down. Those 20 people would no longer be there. And now you have, again, another issue that's creating a cash flow issue for you. I think the biggest issue that I wanted to really focus on is this last slide right here. What we have really been focusing on is putting together 13-week cash flow statements for the staffing companies. And basically, it's a very straightforward cash flow. It looks at what you had in AR. It looks what you had in AP. It adds in what you have for your operating expenses. And you just push it out over a 13-week period. And you start changing the timing of those receivables you had. What would happen to your cash flow if receivables were moved out 15 days, if they were moved out 25 days, if they were moved out 45 days, or if they were moved out 60 days? And therefore, that will help demonstrate to you that, yes, I really did need this cash, because once my receivables start dwindling and I didn't have any cash coming in over the last 90 days, that became a real serious effect for me to be able to pay my obligations. And remember, the biggest obligation of a staffing firm is the people. It's your paychecks that you're paying the people. And if I'm paying them on a Friday and I'm not collecting that receivable for 60 days, that means I'm not turning my receivables, for two times, three times like I'm used to doing. All of a sudden, that cash flow dries up in that 60-day period. How do we plan on paying for our employees? And that's one of the key areas that I believe that for staffing firms, we have to make sure you're focusing on, is focus on that 13-week cash flow and what happens if you had not gotten this loan or those receivables were pushed out. Anything else you'd like to add on there, Marty, as we get through this?
Just a couple things. I mean, Jerry, I think the advice you just gave about preparing for an audit is spot on and very similar to the advice that we've been giving. We've been asked a number of times working with folks like you to give actually opinion letters that a borrower has in fact you know, executed its certification in good faith. And lo and behold, our opinion letters really track very much what you just said, right? I mean, it's a very complicated question now, because it's really a two-part question, right? The economic uncertainty and then the liquidity, and you gotta kind of look at it as a whole. So you need to look at what that impact is, and we've been talking about all the same things you did. Is there economic impact that's already shown up in your financial performance? Are there leading indicators that are down, or are your number of orders down, number of placements down? Is the time to place people down? Is the amount of time that they're lasting on assignments down? You know, all those leading indicators that may not be showing up in your financial performance now, but will be showing up in your financial performance down the road. What does your industry look like? All of those things that you said that could be substantial impacts on how you're operating, I think you right on point with how we've been going through it. And then you got to look at the liquidity, as you said. And geez, those cash flow statements and projections are so important, because they're the foundation of measuring liquidity, right? Because until you understand what your cash is going to look like and what your cash flow is, right? You can't determine whether your liquidity is sufficient to bridge you without the PPP loan. So that's been the foundation of the opinions that we've been given. And then once we understand what the cash flow is like, then we look at what the liquidity is. Is there cash on hand? Is there access to an existing line of credit? And then you kind of look at the whole picture, right? And I'll quick examples. We had a client that had very little financial impact measured right now. They were doing their cash flow projections and they were doing their financial projections into the future. And there looked like in a worst case scenario that there could be a negative cash flow of about 50 grand a month for the next 6 months. On the other hand, they had liquidity of substantial cash liquidity. So it was pretty clear from that circumstance that this borrower was not a candidate. On the other hand, you know, we've seen folks with, and you described a good situation where they had one client's plant shut down, right? Well, it's certainly likely that at some point in the next 6 months, another client's plant will have the same problem. So when they started factoring in those impacts, you could see that their negative cash flow or the potential negative cash flow was substantial. Their ABL loan base was shrinking because their receivables went from 33-day average to a 62-day average, and they were projecting it was going to go further, so their borrowing base was going to shrink. And was it clear when we put the whole picture together that they, in fact, were certifying in good faith? One question we keep coming back to, Jerry, and I think that maybe this might be the last question on this topic, is owner's comp, right? And how does that face fit into liquidity? And there's always two different types of owner's comp. There's owners who work every day in the business, typically in a C-level position. CEO is the most typical position. But then you also have owners who are more passive in a company, but yet are receiving dividends and distributions. And a lot of owners keep coming to us, well, you know, I make X and we distribute Y to folks. You know, is that part of cash flow? How have you been answering those questions?
The distribution standpoint is going to be a very unique issue as the SBA goes through this audit. You know, if I'm a CEO and I'm being paid a fair salary, the SBA is not going to look at that real hard. They are going to look at it if you all of a sudden start taking a higher salary than you previously had. Excuse me. That's kind of one of the reasons they put it at $100,000. Is because they wanted to limit the salary. They didn't want the lending to be an avenue for owners to start getting free cash somewhere and be able to have that cash coming to them. The distributions, what we are recommending to people is that the distribution should be based on the cash flow without any consideration of the SBA funds being utilized. So by that, I mean that if I received a $500,000 SBA loan, and before I use that money to pay my wages and my overhead, what was my cash flow going to be? because what you want to do is you want to wait until you get through that whole SBA 8-week period, because if all of a sudden you start taking the same amount of distribution or more distribution, it could lend one to think that, hey, you had quite some liquidity there because you still have a lot of cash left over from the SBA loan, and you took it all out to yourself. So really, you really didn't have any business liquidity issues. So it's going to be a really tough issue, Marty. And I think that we just have to, we planned on demonstrating on our 13-week cash flows that it was going to be a 13-week cash flow without any lending involved, and then saying, well, we can't take a distribution this period because we wouldn't have cash to do it. So I think if that's what you were looking for, Marty, that's how we're kind of looking at in our avenue. Make sense?
Yeah, no, that was exactly the type of guidance that I was curious to hear from you. I guess we should turn it over to Ali at this
point. Yep. Yep. And Ali's going, and we're trying, and see how fast we're talking, Lonnie? We know we want you to talk today, so we are moving quick. So Ali's going to talk about the borrower's use of funds, and he's also going to talk about how we go about doing loan forgiveness. So Ali, thank you so much, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you, Jerry. Good afternoon, everybody. So when it comes to loan forgiveness, the key starts with understanding some of the key terminologies that came through the Act and then that came through subsequent rules, as well as the application that was most recently released. The application was released a few weeks ago, and then the actual rules that finally cemented things came throughout the weekend, as Jerry mentioned, over Memorial Day weekend. So these definitions are lined up here. We're going to go through each one of them in detail. Then we're going to get a refresher on what the allowable uses of the funds are, what's eligible for forgiveness and what's not. And then we're going to talk about some reductions and exemptions that would impact the otherwise forgiveness amount. So when we start with the definitions, we're going to walk through the covered period and alternative covered period. Jerry, if we can go to the next slide, please.
Yep. Sorry about that.
So covered period, this one is a very key terminology. As it stands currently, that's the 8-week period from the time you get the money. So it starts on the day you are funded, and then it's 55 days after that. So that's the full 8-week period. This applies to both, could apply to payroll, but it definitely applies to non-payroll costs. Now, the application, as well as the rules, came up with an alternative payroll covered period. This is a covered period that applies only to the payroll component of the allowable uses. And essentially, what came up here is borrowers who have a biweekly or more frequent pay schedule can elect to start their 8-week period for payroll only on the first day of that first pay period within the covered period that they got their money. So if somebody received their money on May 1st, and that was within like midway through a biweekly pay period, and their biweekly pay period ended on May 7th, they can elect to start their 8-week period for payroll only on that May 8th forward, essentially. And why this is important, it's because a lot of people had difficulties rehiring people quickly, and so they needed a little bit of time. So this could give somewhere between a few days all the way up to a week, maybe a little bit more, to push that 8-week period so that you can include payrolls that are otherwise maybe more robust or have more costs to them. Again, this is only for biweekly or more frequent payers and only for payroll related expenses. Next slide, please. So full-time equivalents, that was a key term that was introduced by the Act. This is going to come into play when we talk about the reductions that would apply to PPP loans. There's a lot of talk, essentially, when the full-time equivalents were released, the only frame of reference people had was the Affordable Health Care Act. That was talking about any employee who had 30 hours or more was considered a full-time equivalent. The SBA came up and said, yeah, we considered 30 hours, but we felt that 40 makes a lot more sense. And as a result, now every employee who on average per week works more than 40 hours is considered a full-time equivalent. And the maximum you can get is a 1.0. So if somebody works on average 50 hours, it's still considered just one. Anybody who works less than 40 hours on average per week is going to get either the quotient. So somebody works 30 hours, for example, 30 over 40 is a 0.75, or you can use a simplified methodology of applying a 0.5 measurement for every employee that's lower than 40. That's completely at the election of the borrower. It just has to be applied consistently across the board. So you can't pick and choose which employee you want to use this on or which period you want to use this on. There's a lot of confusion about how do you calculate the hours per week, the average hours per week. That has not been determined exactly by the SBA. So some are taking, you know, each week and measuring full-time equivalents there and then taking an average, while others are just combining the hours for the full 8-week period, for example, per employee, and then dividing that by 8 to come up with an average per week. I think you use the strategy that's most advantageous to you, as long as you get to a per week average until further guidance come about to determine that on a more exact basis. The full-time equivalent measurement periods, those are critical periods that come into the reduction. And essentially those are February 15th through June 30th, 2019, or January 1st, 2020 to February 29th, 2020. And if you are a seasonal employer, it's either one of those two periods above, or you can choose any consecutive 12-week period from May 1st through September 15th, 2019. So allowable uses. The PPP funds that's eligible for forgiveness are going to go into two buckets. There's a payroll cost bucket and there's non-payroll cost buckets. And there's a limitation, you've heard of the rules, the 75-25% split. That's why you got to look at them into those two buckets. Plus, as we discussed, there's the covered period that could apply to payroll costs only, but would not apply to non-payroll costs. So that's why I would recommend for everybody to just look at those two separate components. Now, payroll costs, that has the same definitions that came through from early on. It's the same kind of baseline that was used for people to borrow based off of the 2.5 times the funds. And that includes gross cash wages that are earned payable to the employees. Now, what the forgiveness rules clarified is that hazard pay, bonuses, payments to furloughed employees will be allowed. So they will not be challenged, but they are still subject to the $100,000 maximum prorated cap that's available per employee. So, and that includes now vacation, you know, separation pay, health insurance costs, employer portion, retirement plan contributions, also the employer portion, and then the unemployment taxes for the state and local governments. If you have SE individuals or partners in a partnership, essentially the SE income attributable to those partnerships, to those partners from 2019 is what comes into the payroll cost definition. Next slide, please. Thank you. So self-employed individual, as talked, they're capped at their 2019 Schedule C profits as prorated, or a maximum of $15,385. Now, what's very interesting is that the forgiveness rules, as well as the application, came up with a new concept, which is this concept of owner-employee. And owner-employee is not defined. So as it stands currently, you'd have to assume that anybody who is a shareholder or a partner in a partnership that could potentially be receiving any type of compensation or wage is going to be defined as an owner-employee. And the reason why this is critical is because now owner-employees are capped at the lesser of their 2019 cash compensation, including health insurance and retirement plan, multiplied by 8 over 52, so the 8-week equivalent of their 2019 cash compensation, or $15,385. So it's the similar cap that's available on self-employed individual is now available on owner employees. So if somebody is a shareholder in S corporation, this would apply to them. And essentially that means that an owner employee cannot raise their wage from the 2019 limits to a higher number to benefit from PPP funds. They're capped at what they were making before. What's also important is now this cap is applicable on all affiliated businesses. And so that means if you have a shareholder that had a couple of companies and maybe were taking payroll from both companies, they're looking at things more combined, and you get to use $115,385 for that owner employee. So that's a material change from how it was before. The $15,385 was always the limit. However, for regular employees, it was a limit on cash compensation only. So you could use $15,385 of cash compensation and tack on health insurance benefits and retirement benefits. Now, for self-employed individuals and owner employees, you cannot do that. So if you pay somebody over 100 grand on a prorated basis, you get $15,385, and that's pretty much it. So excluded from payroll costs are the following. That has not changed. Essentially, it's compensation paid to employees whose principal residence outside the U.S., any qualified sick leave or family leave pay that came from the Family First Corona Response Act, the employer portion of any FICA taxes. If you're a company, you cannot include your 1099 people on payroll, in payroll cost. And then every employee is capped, as we discussed, to a $100,000 prorated cap. So that's $15,385 for the 8-week period. Non-payroll costs, so that's bucket number two, is interest on mortgage obligations. Here, the clarification came that any prepayment of interest is explicitly not allowed. This excludes principal, of course. Rent payments, that now includes rents on, or confirmed that includes rents on real or and personal property. So I think that's very advantageous to certain taxpayers. Seeing that in manufacturing space, there's a lot of folks that have lease payments on equipment. Now they can include that. If you have vehicle leases, that could be included. Just keep in mind that all of these are related to service agreements that were in place before February 15th, 2020. So if you just entered into an agreement, that will not count. It's anything that was in place before February 15th, 2020. And then utility payments, there's still this concept of transportation, which is a little bit of a gray area. What's interesting is the self-employed rules that came out about a month ago did mention that self-employed individuals may utilize a vehicle fuel as part of their eligible costs, but it's not clarified that this same concept applies all across the board, because anything that's not related to self-employed has not made that reference. So that transportation definition within utilities is still a question mark. And then you can use PPP funds on interest of any other indebtedness, which means lines of credit, if you have any equipment, loans, capital leases, stuff of that nature, but that will not be eligible for forgiveness. So it's only interest on mortgage obligations that's eligible for forgiveness. And then last, no more than 25% of the amount forgiven can be attributable to non-payroll costs. And so that means that if you want your loan to be forgiven in full, you'd have to at least spend 75% of your funds on payroll. 25% can go onto these funds. Another clarification that came up is this concept of incurred versus costs paid. And so now borrowers are eligible for forgiveness for costs paid or payroll costs incurred within the 8-week period. So the cover period or the alternative cover period. So that first payroll that could have hit that still covered a couple of weeks before the 8-week period does count. And then on the back end, if you have a payroll that covers some paid time within the 8-week period that wasn't paid till after the end of that, as long as it's paid within the regular payroll cycle, that will then be able to be prorated and utilized within the time period. Same as with non-payroll costs. Any cost that was paid within that 8-week period will qualify. If you have bills that run across that 8-week period but is paid afterwards, as long as it's paid within its normal billing cycle, you can use some sort of proration. This seems to suggest that you can essentially pay anything you want within the 8-week period, because what the SBA is looking like, it's relying on is the fact that you have 25% cap on what you can utilize. And as a result, that's how they're going to do a catch-all on maximizing what people can include in that 8-week period. So this is an example that they gave. Essentially, somebody who's got a June 1st through July 26 can pay a bill from May within that period and still essentially count it. And then, like we talked, on the 8-week back end, they can still prorate as long as it was paid within its normal billing cycle. So reductions. So the first big reduction that's out there is related to a number of employees. So that's an FTE headcount reduction that's available. And what the way this works is essentially you have to benchmark the number of full-time equivalents that you have during the cover period or alternative cover period, whichever one you choose. You have to benchmark it against the two measurement periods that we discussed, which is February 15, 2019 through June 30th, 2019, or January 1st, 2020 through February 29th, 2020. Keep in mind, if you're seasonal, you have a third option there, which is that 12-week period. But essentially, you're going to measure the FTEs the same way for each of those periods. And then you're going to use the lesser. You get to choose the lesser of the two numbers. And then you measure your FTEs for the 8-week period, and you get a ratio of those two. So if you had 100 people on average during one of the two measurement periods, but you now only have 80 people during your 8-week covered period, that means you're at 80% employment from where you were. So that means your allowable expenses that we talked about, so that bucket of cost that you actually spent, will get a 20% haircut on reduction. And so if you spent $1 million, but you did only hit that 80% mark, 20% of that million will not be forgiven. So that's $200,000 that will get reduced in this example. And again, full-time equivalent, now you're using essentially a 40-hour divider. And then you get to use a simplified method for people who don't meet the 40-hour rule by applying a 0.5. Just remember, consistent across all measurement periods that you're going to be utilizing. So there's a couple of reduction exceptions that came out to help borrowers, mainly because initially the law, you could have a reduction, but that did not have, you know, like people would leave voluntarily or somebody would get fired for cause. There was no distinction about that piece. So the SBA recognized that and said, if you fired somebody for cause, they voluntarily resign, they decide to reduce their own hours. Or most importantly, if you have people on unemployment and you essentially offered them their job back and they refused, that you get accepted from considering those components as a reduction in your FTE. And so we're just going to go through the unemployment exceptions just so you're aware of what you need to do there to qualify for that. So for you to qualify from exempting somebody who was on unemployment or refused to come back, essentially you have to make the offer in writing to rehire them. It has to be for the same salary or wage and the same number of hours that they were working before. They have to reject the offer, and you have to have record of that rejection. And then last, which is the big piece, is you have to inform the unemployment insurance agency of the fact that they rejected the offer. So essentially, they're going to forfeit their unemployment benefit by doing so technically. And if you do all that, then you will not consider to have had a reduction for that particular full-time equivalent employee. The second reduction that applies is the salary and wage reduction. This one actually is a more difficult calculation, but a lot simpler in concept now. And in essence, it's more of an hourly rate comparison or a salary comparison. Initially, we thought they were going to do some sort of averaging of amount paid. So we're afraid that reduction in hours like or overtime rates could impact you. Doesn't seem to be the case. They're looking at base salary, and we believe that they're going to be looking at base hourly rates. And so essentially, as long as you did not have a reduction of more than 25% in somebody's pay, you should not be dinged for this. But if you had that, any excess over 25% would be a reduction dollar for dollar against the amount that's eligible for forgiveness. So for example, somebody who was making $20 an hour, as long as you didn't reduce that hourly rate to any lesser than 15, you should not have this apply to you. If you did, the excess times the number of hours that they essentially work in the 8-week period would be a dollar for dollar reduction in your FTE or in your, sorry, forgiveness. And what's important is this testing only applies to people who made $100,000 or less in 2019. So if you reduce some of the highly compensated people, or if an owner takes their salary down, they will not be impacted by this if they were making more than $100,000. So now we talked about the couple of reductions that's out there, but with every rule, there's an exception. And here we are. We have safe harbor exemptions. So those also could be favorable now for borrowers. Currently, there is those two reductions that we talked about. Essentially, what they said is if you had a reduction in FTE or salary and wages between February 15th and April 26, 2020, as compared to what it was on Feb 15, so it's important that you show that you had a reduction. If you didn't have a reduction in that time period, you cannot use this. So you first have to demonstrate that you had that reduction. Second, if you then restore that reduction by June 30th to the same level that you had on Feb 15, then even though you might have had a reduction in between in your 8-week period that would have affected your forgiveness, you are exempted from having to apply that. So essentially what they're telling people is, look, if you had to lay off people and then by June 30th, you go back to the same level of people that you had on February 15th, we're not going to hurt you by any of these salary or wage reduction or FTE reduction. Important to note that the FTE reduction is kind of an all or nothing, so you got to get back to that headcount. Whereas a salary reduction, because the measurement is on an employee by employee basis, then you can apply the safe harbor for one employee, but not meet it for another. So one of them could be kind of, you can pick and choose where the other, you actually have to reach that number again for it to all not apply to you. So now we just want to cover some of these questions that seem to be lingering. What I talked to Jerry a little bit is, you know, every time I do this slide and there's new guidance and we have to update the PowerPoint that comes out, I get excited because I delete like four of them and then I add four more. And it seems like this slide just keeps on staying as is every time we update this. With that, we're still looking for a definition of transportation cost. Now this owner-employee concept, we're looking to see if they're gonna do any de minimis rules that would apply. FTE reduction, you know, how are you gonna measure that really? Is it just 8 weeks or is it gonna be using the payroll record? Because now with this paid and incurred, you can have more than 8 weeks worth of payroll really included, especially if you count that first pay period that covers 2 weeks, that could be covering 2 weeks. That did not be part of the 8-week period. LLC members, you know, the forgiveness rules only mention general partners for the cap purposes. We believe LLC members will be included, but it's interesting that they only mention general partners. And then ultimately what's gonna happen with the 8-week period, you know? It's a big thing right now. A House passed a bill looking for 24-week instead of 8. The Senate has a 16-week bill. So it seems like there's consensus that things should be extended a little bit, but nothing has yet passed. And so what's going to happen to that and how that's going to impact a lot of decisions is going to be interesting to see in the upcoming days.
Excuse me, Amanda, is there any questions regarding the forgiveness piece that we might want to dive into real quickly?
Sure, we do have some questions that have come in. I'll read off what we have so far. One question is, can you start your covered period when the state was on lockdown?
No, your covered period essentially starts once you get the money. So the fact that the state was on lockdown or not is not, does not come into play here. It's the moment that cash hits your bank account, you automatically start your covered period.
Another question is, how do we qualify salary reductions for employees who were laid off? Does that show up as a wage reduction to zero?
So employees who were laid off are not going to come and get impacted by the salary reduction. They will be impacted by the FTE reduction because their hours essentially could have gotten reduced or eliminated. But the SBA is very conscious on not double dipping. So any type of reduction that relates to hours is going to be measured as part of the FTE reduction. And as long as the rate that you pay them is the same that you were paying them in the first quarter of 2020, the salary reduction will not come into play.
And another question that has come in, must owner health insurance have run through the company?
Depends on the type of business that you are. Yes, if you are like an S corporation or a C corporation, then I would say yes. If you're a self-employed individual, then technically that's not going to come into play because they're using your Schedule C basis, which is a number that's before any health insurance deduction typically. And so you are inadvertently getting the benefit of your health insurance that way. So I would say that, yes, you have to have everything that we're talking about as expenses have to be company-based expenses or in the name of the borrower, essentially.
Okay. If we had employees who resigned between January and February of 2020, i.e. before the covered period, would they be included as FTEs for comparative purposes, or can they be excluded?
What was the first part of the question?
If we had employees who resigned between January and February of 2020.
Yep. Okay. So for that, the exceptions seem to only apply for during the covered period. So if you had those employees and they resigned in January and February, then you will take them out of your FTE headcount. So that will show a lower base for that period. But during the covered period, it seems like those exceptions would apply. So that could help you.
Are you able to use PPP funds to pay recruiters who are 100% commission-based?
As long as they're on payroll, their wages and salaries will count, yes. But if they are 1099 type people, then no.
Is the forgiveness amount whether 50% or 100% taxable?
The forgiveness amount is not taxable. Any amount that's cancellation of debt because of the forgiveness is not included in taxable income. However, any of the expenses paid by PPP money that's otherwise forgiven are not allowed as a tax deduction. So it's a wash, pretty much.
Okay. If we reduced staff and then rehired same number during the same covered period as we reduced, but not the same employees, how does that balance out?
That is perfectly fine. It's essentially, as long as you have the number right, it doesn't matter that it's the same employee.
Okay. If I get back to exact FTE count headcount by June 30th and have used the 75-25 model, I will have 100% forgiveness. What if I get to 80% headcount, then do I owe 20%?
You know, the numbers could vary a little bit without seeing the numbers. It's tough to say, but in theory, is if you get to 80% and you don't meet the safe harbor exemptions, then whatever amount that's you've spent will get a 20% haircut. So yes, you will get 20% reduced forgiveness. But if you get to the June 30th FTE, then the 20, even though you were at 80% during the 8-week period, that 20% will not apply anymore because you've met the safe harbor exemption, and you can get 100% of whatever you spend forgiven.
Wondering if we can count 9 weeks of payroll in the following scenario. We received the funds on 4/16, which is a Thursday. Our pay date is Friday. Can we count the Friday 4/17 paid payroll? Can we also count all the payroll through June 11th? We are moving to the last pay date to Thursday, so effectively 9 weeks of payroll.
Yes, that's accurate. Right now, that's why they came up with the paid or incurred, and that becomes very advantageous to the borrowers, and that allows them to include that first payroll, even though it wasn't really incurred within that 8-week period. But they're looking at anything that was paid, they're counting it.
Okay, so those are the questions we've received thus far. If anyone has additional questions, feel free to submit them through the chat or the Q&A feature.
Thanks, Amanda. Yep, thank you. Go ahead, Marty.
No, I was just going to make sure that we got to hear from Lonnie.
Here we go. So I'd like to introduce Lonnie. She will be going through some of the tax updates for everybody. We have really six
tax updates that we felt were important, that we feel that the staffing industry should really be focusing on, because all six of these do have the ability to increase some cash flow needs for the organization. So Lonnie, with that, we'll go ahead and start.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you, everyone. And I realize that I'm going to do this at lightning speed, just in the interest of time. So we'll touch on a couple of things, but when you get the access to the slides, if you have any questions on anything, absolutely feel free to reach out to us. So in the first slide, as we've mentioned with the CARES Act and the PPP program, there's some other incentives to keep people employed. The first one, which is just a bullet point, was the Family First Coronavirus Response Act, which was the paid sick leave and then the paid family leave for those who had children at home. We're not going to dive into those details, but we're going to get into another credit. So if you could do the next slide, please, Jerry. You're fine. You're good there. So the employee retention credit. I want to point out first that you're not eligible for the employee retention credit if you received a Paycheck Protection Program loan. So theoretically, everyone on this presentation who's listening to this has a loan. So just know that if you did in fact apply or use this credit prior to receiving your PPP loan, that you have to recapture that credit and pay it back to the IRS. So if you go to the next slide, Jerry, just to highlight a couple of the items. So the employee retention credit is for those that were affected by the pandemic, and that you're eligible for a credit of, it amounts to up to $5,000 per employee, up to what, you know, the wages of $10,000. So go ahead, Jerry. So yes, as we touched on, eligible employers are those that were fully or partially shut down in any quarter because of the pandemic, or those that experienced a significant decline in gross receipts, which is defined as more than 50%. Go ahead, Jerry. The qualified wages, it varies based on the number of employees that you have. If you have 100 or less employees, any wages you pay to a person are eligible for the credit. But if you have more than 100, it's only wages paid to those people who are not working for you. So, and teleworking is considered working. So it'd be somebody who you're paying to sit at home is where you'd be eligible for that credit. Go ahead, Jerry. There was one other piece regarding the deferral of payroll taxes. And initially it was thought that this deferral couldn't be used if you received a PPP loan, but an IRS issued a frequently asked question stating that you are eligible to defer your employer's share of Social Security taxes, so just the 6.2%, until you receive PPP loan forgiveness. So even though you've received the funds and you're utilizing the funds, not until that loan is forgiven are you then no longer eligible to defer these payroll taxes on the wages paid. So theoretically, during all of this time, you could be deferring the employer's share of Social Security taxes until a later date. And if you go to the next slide, Jerry, the dates are actually on the next slide. We'll get there. But and ultimately you take the credit by, in a sense, shorting your payroll taxes on the payroll tax return. So next slide, Jerry. There you go. Perfect. One more. Yeah. So just, I wanted to point out that the amount, the deferral is due in 50% increments. One's due in December of 2021. The other's due in December of 22. So even though you're no longer eligible for the deferral because your PPP loan is forgiven, it doesn't accelerate those dates that you have to pay it back. You still have until December of 2021 and December of 2022. Go ahead, Jerry. Something else to be aware of, and I'm going to speed through this part, would be the net operating losses. They undid with the CARES Act some changes under tax reform, and that net operating losses can be carried back up to 5 years. So if 2018 had a loss, or maybe 2019 ended up being a loss year for you, you do have the option to carry those losses back and recoup some cash in that way. Go ahead, Jerry. Because the IRS offices are shut down, they have are allowing forms to be faxed, which has not traditionally happened, and it's a faster way to get your money. But but there is a June 30th deadline to submit these 1139 and 1045 forms. So if it's something that interests you, make sure you're talking to your tax advisor. Go ahead, Jerry. One other change with the tax reform from 2017 was there's limits on business interest expense deduction. They've relaxed those limitations some, so you may be able to take advantage of greater interest expense deductions. Go ahead, Jerry. The CARES Act also repaired something from tax reform related to accelerated depreciation on leasehold improvement. So if in 2018 or 2019, let's say you renovated an office or your office space, the CARES Act corrected that you could deduct that 100% in the year for depreciation, or take one, instead of doing it over 39 years, you get to do it all in 1 year. So that may generate some, if it's NOLs or a deduction, that may help recoup some cash as well. You can either file it using an accounting method change or an amended return. So make sure you're talking to your tax advisor about that. Go ahead, Jerry. And then last item is if anybody gets to the point, or if it's one planning item they'd like to use, is that you are able to take a premature retirement plan distribution. Typically, there's a 10% penalty imposed on any early distributions. The CARES Act waives that penalty on any COVID-19 distribution, which is a distribution in any time during 2020. And then on the next slide, it covers a qualified individual. And so if it's someone who is diagnosed, a family member was diagnosed, adverse financial consequences because of being quarantined, furloughed, unable to work, that you can take money out of your retirement plan. Next slide, Jerry. And so then what happens is you recognize that income. So if you took a $9,000 distribution from your retirement plan, you would pay income taxes on it. You would report that income over a 3-year period. So starting with 2020, 2021, and 2022, you have up until 3 years to pay that loan back or replenish that distribution, let's say. And if you do that by 2022, in our example, you could file amended returns for 2020 and 2021 to recoup any taxes that you paid on that income at that point. And I realized that that was a lot of tax education in, I think, 6 minutes. So I apologize for that, but let us know if you have any questions.
Yeah, a couple of key things I just want to add to that, Lonnie, and thank you so much, because I know those items were pretty quick, but we are seeing in the staffing industry, we're seeing a lot of generation of potential NOLs for this year, because many of you are on a cash basis tax return. But in addition, as Ali said, you have to be cautious, because the expenses you are paying with your PPP loan will not be a deductible item on your tax return. You're going to really need to look at some planning and make sure that you are mapping this out over the next 6 months. In addition, the interest expense is for those companies that only have gross receipts greater than 25 million. But the big issue is the deferral of the FICA tax, which many companies were still not doing because they thought, because they did get a PPP loan, they were not able to. And that is a big cash flow item that, until that loan is actually forgiven, you do have the ability to continue to defer. And that could lead you all the way to September or October, because by the time you use your funds, by the time you get your application in for your loan forgiveness, and by the time they forgive it, it could be September or October. So I would not lose sight of that, because it is a good cash flow item. With that, Amanda, is there any other questions?
Yes, there are quite a few questions. So I did go ahead and open the poll. If you'd please give us your feedback as we go through some of these questions. I'll read off some questions. Jerry, would you mind going to the next slide? It'll have the contact information.
Yep.
There we go. So that, you know, if anyone wants to hang around for additional questions, we'll cover a few additional here. So another question is, as an LLC taxed as a partnership, for 2020 flow through tax, is taxable net income calculation not reduced by payroll?
If I'm understanding what they're saying is that any payroll, if they're talking about the payroll as a deduction, any payroll that is going to be paid by the PPP program would not be deductible on that tax return. That would be the answer, if I'm understanding the question.
Yeah, correct. And then for self-employed individual, essentially the forgiveness is an automatic based on the 8-week equivalent of their 2019 amount. So there's really nothing there to really spend it on from a self-employed piece.
Okay. For self-funded insurance plans, can we use both the employer-provided payroll credit and our fixed cost plus claims?
So you should be able to use the full fees that you pay for the self-insured plus, yes, the self, the claims that you'll be funding.
During those period, for that period, the covered period. Yep. For the covered period.
If the employee reimburses anything, you have to essentially net that against your cost.
Can PEO administrative fees be included in payroll expenses or other allowable expenses?
PEO administrative fees. You know, that's not covered anywhere, but I would say that is, if it's separately stated, I would say that's no. If it's baked into an employee number, I would say included. If it's separately stated, that's more of a professional fee and it probably would not qualify.
On the application on page 9, table 1, it states in the second bullet point listing all people that received compensation for all the pay periods in 2019. Why would it state that in the same table for the covered period?
It's essentially they're looking for, if I'm thinking of the right one, they're looking for the people who made less than $100,000 so that they can measure them against for the salary reduction piece. However, that salary reduction, you know, you're only really putting the people that are in your 8-week period with salaries less than $100,000 in 2019.
Okay, as a healthcare staffing agency, they've been able to keep the same amount of working temps at hospitals and no indication yet that clients wouldn't be able to pay. Does this play a negative factor in applying to forgiveness?
We're a healthcare, we have been able to keep the same amount of working time to hospitals, no indication yet. I think this goes back to Jerry, to you on the certifications. You know, there's two components to it. There was the uncertainty and there's the liquidity piece of it. You know, the fact that you haven't been impacted will play a role, but it's not, I don't think it's not like the kiss of death. You still right. have to do the analysis though to demonstrate the need that you needed for that money. And if you didn't get the money, what would it have looked like? Because sometimes there's also delayed impacts for some of these PPPs, but there's no question that if you have zero impact and everything is going great, that could have an impact on your eligibility for the loan. Yes.
Do you anticipate a 1% 2-year loan being extended to 5 years or even greater?
There is that discussion out there of potentially extending the maturity date. There's nothing concrete. But it does seem like there's a consensus of giving a little bit more relief than currently is out there. So that's not very, you know, hopefully by the next week, we'll know once things run through the Senate.
How do staffing agencies handle wage reduction if the employer is on the employee is on an assignment that is a different wage? If we do not have any wage reductions, do we need to do the calculations?
So you have to do the calculation pretty much regardless, but you inherently know if you didn't have a wage reduction that you're going to have zero essentially on that. But should they ask for the backup, you have to be able to demonstrate that you looked at it and that you don't have a reduction. Jerry, you want to shed some light on if they have a different assignment with a lower wage? I mean,
Yeah, I mean, that it's definitely going to be, they have to keep that pay rate the same to that employee. And that's going to be the issue, that I understand that they may get a lower rate from the client, but they got to pay them the same. Unfortunately, it's a 25% rule.
Does taking an economic injury loan, not the advance, but the actual loan, impact a line of credit?
A line of credit. So what people need to be aware about the EIDL loans is that those loans are not subject to forgiveness, and those loans could require collateral. And essentially, that could clash with existing lender debt that's currently out there. So they just need to be aware of that. So as long as your bank, if you have a line of credit with them, are okay with the fact that there's a lien also from the EIDL and the SBA, then you should be fine.
Correct.
Do you still get 100% forgiveness if you hire the balance of employees on June 29th? Needed to make the June 30th FTE quota.
Yeah, what's interesting in that is the way the law reads is you have to do that no later than June 30th, but then the application itself has a June 30th hard date on it. And the June 30th itself is not really defined how do you get there, but the February 15th date is essentially calculated based on the pay period in which February 15th falls. So if you think that June 30th would follow the same logic, you're really looking at that pay period in which June 30th falls. And that's where you want to make sure that across that whole pay period, you have restored the number. And so if that starts on June 27th, then be ready to have the number of FTEs by that date, available so you can meet that that criteria.
So by doing it inside the payroll period date is where you want to do it.
Thank you. Another question is, how do these affect the Work Opportunity Tax Credit Program?
I haven't read of any interactions with that program. Should be able to still qualify for it. The only thing that you cannot get is the employee retention credit. Lonnie, have you seen anything on the WOTCs?
Not specifically.
No, not specific to that either. Me neither.
I have a client who is requesting gross payroll wages and the related employer portion of state and local taxes as they are using for their PPP loan forgiveness. The employees are on my payroll and not my clients. How has this issue been going?
So for staffing companies, you are the employer that gets the PPP on that payroll. Your clients, to them, those are temp employees. They're not actual employees. They cannot utilize that in their payroll base. If it was a PEO situation, it'd be different. The co-employer can use those. But when it comes to staffing, it's the staffing company that gets the PPP money on that payroll.
Okay, good. Thank you for covering that. Will the forgivable amount need to be declared as income?
Not for tax purposes, excluded. But if you have financial statements, then there's going to be some sort of either income or recognition through equity because it's grant. But it's likely going to go through other income as grant income.
Deferring FICA taxes, how reported and paid on 941s?
They're actually updating the 941 right now, and there will actually be a change. Those should be out sometime in the middle of June is what we've been told, but there will actually be a box line on there that talks about what was deferred, that you deferred out. So it will be on the new 941 that's coming out.
So salary is not deductible, but what about payroll taxes related to those salaries?
Yeah, since payroll taxes are not allowable as payroll costs in PPP, the employer portion, those should remain as deductible.
Okay, we are going to start to wrap things up here. I know there are still probably lots of questions on people's minds, but just in the interest of everyone's time here, if you have further questions, please feel free to reach out to any of our presenters directly. They'd be happy to help you. They're definitely the experts in the area. I'd like to thank you all for your time in today's webinar session, and certainly our panel members for sharing their knowledge about the current and ever-changing roles of the PPP and CARES Act and where we are today with that. Thank you again so much for your time, and watch for information on additional webinar sessions.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.